Alright guys, so I wanted to show you what SolidWorks has to offer as far as dynamic analysis of our system for senior design. The good thing about using SolidWorks is that all you have to do is input a force in order to get out things like displacement, velocity, and acceleration of our piston system. Basically, you can input all the properties of the neodymium magnets. I already have the dimensions in there, assuming that they're perfect. 16th inch neodymium magnets with 6 1/32nd inch thickness discs. Those neodymium magnets inside a 16th inch diameter internal tube that's 3 inches long on the inside. So that's what our system is right now as far as this analysis goes. We can change the dimensions of it anything we want to and run another analysis, but this is just what I went with for just testing purposes of what SolidWorks can do. The good thing is that you can input your materials, you can input the coefficients of friction, kinetic and static, as well as the B values that'll be resisting the movement of the piston as velocity changes. So that's what's really good about using the SolidWorks analysis, motion analysis, for our senior design. And I'm going to show you an animation of what it looks like right now at the set force I have at, and I'll show you what it is, but it looks like this. The piston is moving back and forth as expected, and I'll slow it down a good bit so I can tell you what's going on and how it's doing it. So you see the piston moving back and forth, I hope. You see the piston moving back and forth. Basically what's going on is it's given a specific time step, which is the frames per second. It calculates the force on the piston system, on the piston, moves it appropriately, and then recalculates for the next bit. The force is changing, and that's why it's moving back and forth. Now I'll show you what the force looks like after I let it run through one more time pretty slowly. So you can just see there are some like dips in the time step, but we can increase the frames per second. This one is at 32 right now, and you can also always just increase it to ridiculous amounts like 120 and make it recalculate over a 120th of a time step to get better results. So what else does this mean for us? We can get, let me show you what the force has to offer. Basically, this one is just a regular force placed on this face of the piston. So it would be the pressure inside this chamber that's changing. And let's say that this pressure on this side is not, although it will be. I'm using a harmonic force function. That's basically a sine or cosine wave. It has a certain amplitude, so that's the force that it's going to reach at before going back down. And it's pretty small, but relative to our surface area, the pressure differential should be that small in order to generate a good pressure. As well as the force, the frequency can be defined. So the frequency of the system, how often the force is going to be changing back and forth, it's going to be doing a full cycle every 2.5 seconds. So that's everything it does. It can also do, you can change the average. So the average could be at 0.05 seconds instead of zero, and it would reach up to twice that, then come back down to zero. If that makes sense. And I can explain all this in person later. So that's what the force diagram looks like. You can input gravity, so it's at 98.1 meters per second squared, whatever that is in English units. And here's the interesting one. You can pick the two surfaces, so pick the two bodies and choose how they will be in contact with each other. In this case, they're going to have frictions in between the two. So with the ones that they're set right now, it was just kind of around the default area. I didn't think too much to change it at this point since we don't have definite figures. But this VK would be your B value whenever it's moving, and this V of S would be your B value whenever it's not. Relatively zero. So, K, you have your kinetic friction and your static friction, and those can change relative to whatever we find in the material selections. It can do materials, but we'd have to know a lot of the other properties of the materials, as well as it has its own specified materials. So I think it would just be easier to do the frictions. Okay, so that's everything that goes into the analysis, as well as the fact that these both have their own properties. So if we have the properties of the neodymium magnet, we can find the correct mass of our system so that it will move back and forth more accurately. And we can also find the acrylic so that the acrylic, I'm sorry, the Teflon tubing so that it will react appropriately whenever the magnet is moving back and forth. Anyway, all that to say, SolidWorks can use all of those variables at one time, and we can change any of them in order to tweak our system. Here's what it outputs. You can find any of these, but the most important to us will be displacement, velocity, acceleration, mainly displacement. And I'll show you why after a couple seconds. We're going to do it relative to this face right here. And we're going to create a new plot. Sorry, along the x-axis right there. Create a new plot. And here's what it looks like. So this is a plot of the linear displacement of the piston as it moves back and forth relative to time. So you can see it's a pretty nice sine wave. There are some ups and some downs, some ups and some downs, but that's mainly because of the differential time step not being extremely high, causing the piston to hit one side or the other, making it fling back. So whenever doing real analysis, we'll bump it up to a lot higher frequency of calculations, which will increase our computation time, but it'll give us more accurate results. And we'll do a convergence plot to make sure that those results are reaching some value. So, one more thing that it can do is place two plots together. I'm going to show you, that was the incorrect one. I'm going to show you why it would be a bad idea to go ahead and just say the acceleration is correct, at least with what we have right now. So I'm going to do linear acceleration on this plane. Same plane as before. So you see what the acceleration looks like. It's kind of messy, and that's because the force is changing, which changes the acceleration, and it's doing all that based off of the previous time step. So it could start out pretty nice, but it gets ugly very fast, and you reach some pretty high unexpected accelerations. So what would be best is to find out average what this would be as far as a function, then take the derivative of that to find velocity, then derivative of that to find acceleration if we need it, but I think we only need linear displacement per time step for it to find that. And we can take the average of this, and it can be over a longer time period as well. This is only over 5 seconds at a frequency of 10, I believe. 10 hertz. No, it's a frequency of, the force is a frequency of 2.5 hertz. So that's what SolidWorks has to offer as far as the analysis of a dynamic system, specifically the dynamic system we are working with. And like I said, it directly connects with everything we've been talking about. Differential pressures can cause a force on this piston, moving it back and forth. Therefore, we can find everything we need off of that. So that's all I can think of at the moment. That's all I have for you today. If you have any questions, you'll have my number, and you can feel free to contact me if you yay or nay the idea of using SolidWorks. The initial idea we have right now is using SolidWorks to find the linear displacement, and then placing that linear displacement into console using the properties of the magnet as well as its magnetic fields. SolidWorks does not do magnetic fields to the best of my knowledge, so we can import that data into console in order to figure out what power output we should be expecting. But this analysis only took about 5 minutes, and we can change all of these parameters. Say we wanted to see what would happen if we increased the pressure differential, which would increase the force. We can do that very quickly. So let's say it's 0.1, and we're going to do that the same hertz. So recalculate, and it'll recalculate it for us. So the force is higher, meaning it'll probably hit the other side. That would mean we have to increase our frequency for it to oscillate back and forth the way we would like it to. So I think it should stop a good bit. It stopped a good bit, but let me show you what happens if it's not in good sync. And how easy it is to figure out what is good sync for it. So the force is pretty crazy, and it's going to stop for a good bit and then run back and stop for a good bit and then run back. And it's kind of hard to see it because it's stopping for a bit. SolidWorks is realizing that its acceleration is zero, so it's running through the calculations, and you can kind of see it down here, how it's doing that. See, it's moving a little bit faster whenever it's hit the wall. So this would be the method in which, the frequency is off and it's just hitting the wall. So I'll show it to you in a little bit of a slowed motion so you can see it better. So it's moving, hitting, stopping, hitting, stopping. We can use SolidWorks to figure out where that stop would be. As far as frequency, by just changing the frequency. So I'll bump it up to 15 and then recalculate. And it's just that simple as far as changing that one number. And you can see how it's really blocky, really inconsistent, not inconsistent, but it's just really hard to tell what's actually going on from the calculation. We can decrease the time, stop it, look back, play it, it's still kind of hard to tell. So we can open up the results, figure out where the plot is, and all that jazz, and it wouldn't be too much of a hassle to figure out what the new natural frequency is with that force input. And that's what I was thinking as far as calculations and iterations of the mass system. It would eliminate the need for finding the transfer function, inputting the force, and then having some other type of numerical solver calculate it for us. But I wouldn't stray away from the numerical solver too much. It is a good idea to know what our system does numerically, and not just have the computer analyze everything for us. We do have to have some type of reference that we engineered ourselves to say that this model is valid. So just keep that in mind. Anyway, this video is too long, so I'm gonna stop it.